Hello, everybody. I was instructed to remind everybody there's no break between section two and section three, so we have to start right away. This is Hui-Shu Li. I teach Chinese art at UCLA. The next panel, it's about war paintings, art, and devotion. We're going to have three speakers. The first speaker, Professor Sarah Fraser from Heidelberg University. She's the chair of East Asian Art History, also the director of Institute of East Asian Art. Before she left us for Heidelberg, she taught at Northwestern University. She's an extremely dynamic scholar. Maybe some of you know that she's one of the pioneer in digitalizing the Dunhuang cave paintings. Of course, she's very devoted in the study of Buddhist art. In recent years, she has moved on to a new phase other than continue her research in Chinese Buddhist art. Is engaging in something very, I think, extremely admirable, very updated, kind of very cultural discourse about the role of Dunhuang in the 20th and 21st century culture and imagination. And I think today her talk is more, you know, kind of reflect her recent phase of research. So her topic is historical approaches to conservation and copying in the Northwestern frontier, curating, painting, and photographing Dunhuang in the 1940s. Let's welcome Professor Sarah Fraser.
Problems with the pointer a few talks ago have me a little, okay, here we go. Now, thank you very much to the GCI and the GRI for organizing such an interesting conference and the exhibition, and also to the Getty Foundation. They've supported my work since 1998 with various grants, so it's very nice to be here. The human impulse to document and record is especially evident at Dunhuang, where thousands of copies of the murals were made in the last century. And one of the most active periods was ironically during the Second Sino-Japanese War in the 1940s, when links between art, conservation, and cultural nationalism were firmly established, much in the same ways that they still are with us today. Of course, there are deep roots to this story. Displaced anxiety about the occupation of large portions of China by foreign forces over the century of humiliation, and the looting of Dunhuang as a result of colonial expeditions from 1906 to 1914 rendered the monument more than a repository of Buddhist artifacts. But the loss of the Northeast and the establishment of a Japanese colony in Manchuria, Manchukuo, since 1931, transformed the Northwest into a military and intellectual safe zone during the war. Dunhuang's treasures, with their links to the Han and Tang empires, became a symbolic source of pride and evidence of cultural strength, stability, endurance, and ingenuity. After all, extensions of the Great Wall were built and maintained this far west by Emperor Han Wudi and are still visible. With the move of the capital inland to Chongqing in 1937, some of the country's brightest historians, linguists, archaeologists, and artists were in proximity of Dunhuang and other Silk Road sites. As a result, during the war, the cave shrines of both Mogao and Yulin were an important destination. The first nationalized research office was set up in 1943-44, and Chang Suhong, as we've heard, was trained as an artist first in Zhejiang and then in Lyon, France, was the first director. He received crucial intellectual guidance from the Peking University professor Xiang Da, who was a member of the Northwest History and Geography Research Team, the Shibi Kaotatuan. In the lower left, he stands next to Xia Nai in a photograph from 1944. And another important archaeologist, Shijangru, is dwarfed inside a northern Wei niche on the right and also explores Inner Mongolia by camel. Despite the enormous popularity, the question is how much the disparate 1940s audience understood or fully grasped what they viewed in Dunhuang and Newland murals. And in some ways, the details from the north wall in Yulin Cave 25, selected here by me in sort of intentionally, might be a good indication of how visitors tended to view the cave shrines during this period by details rather than comprehensively in holistic units. In wartime, the themes of paradise after rebirth and a future paradise, such as the pairing of Maitreya's future coming and Abhidhamma's promise of paradise after death in the early 9th century cave at Yulin, was a wartime favorite. Visitors naturally gravitated to these themes of peace and tranquility, rebirth and salvation. The exquisite drawing of the scenes of the king and queen and their retinues taking the tonsure to become Buddhists were accessible at eye level, and the layers of underdrawing were visible then as they are here. On the back wall, one of the most celebrated, if more invasive copyists, Zhang Dachen, executed a full-scale, that's a whole nother topic, okay, so executed a full-scale copy with his team of the cosmic Buddha Vairochana, and again, the attention to details, such as style and individual figures, were what would occupy the focus of the painters. The colors are accurate to imagined original tones, bright yellow, red, blue, and green, but the eight great bodhisattvas are eliminated in the copy transfer to silk. And moving around the cave shrine, from the entrance to the inner chamber, it's not too hard to imagine how most of the iconography was a source of bewilderment. So you may not be able to, well, I can try to speak loudly. My point here is just that much of the murals was missing and is still missing today, so that you see this gray conglomerate rock, and much of the iconography is sort of piecemeal. There's smoke damage in these caves, and it's also quite dark. So you can see the kind of conditions that viewing is, and in the 40s as well as today, going from the outside to the inside is very a sort of a transformative experience. So, as a result, artists and visitors gravitated to the colossal images of the Buddha, such as caves 158, 96, and 130, which you see here. The viewing platforms depicted in green outline originally were constructed to provide pilgrims with access to the Buddha's iconic body at three key vantage points, especially providing the all-important darshan, or meeting with the deity's eyes. In the 1940s, the broken facade, faded entryways, and the dark interiors to the cave shrines often distracted visitors and researchers from some of the most important historical parts of the grottoes, the processions of the donor figures that occupied the antechambers and the corridors. Portraits could extend to the interior spaces, numbering into the hundreds, as we see here in cave 98. This social and political network, typically organized by one managing patron, the Kuju, was an index to the political, economic, and military fabric in Dunhuang at any particular moment. Here, hundreds of government officials appear in procession around the bottom edge of the wall, including the commander of the regional armies, the director of area irrigation, the commander of horse pastures to supply the cavalry, etc. Effectively, a social and political map of the Dunhuang era area, circa 920. It dispels the sense that Dunhuang was just a kind of way station on the Silk Road with little local population, and in fact, it gives us specific names and titles for that population. Without getting into a whole lot of detail in another example, but making the larger point about grottoes being indices to social networks, the cave shrines, this cave shrine numbered 61, but called the royal celebration temple, the Huangjingsi, in the medieval period, is a key to giving us a picture of how the cave temples were a social space to reflect or record strategic intermarrying practices by the Dunhuang ruling family in the 10th century. Here, a section of cave, this cave's over 100 female donor portraits that line the walls near the entrance is visible, and they include the sisters and mother and the ethnic Han and Uyghur wives of the local king Cao Yuanzhong. In 980, 3 decades after the initial cave was constructed, the ruler's son married his cousin and the Khotanese princess from the kingdom to the west to secure an alliance. So on the left-hand side, we see some repainting. Much like notations in the family Bible, to use a Christian analogy, the grotto donor portraits were modified to reflect the new unions. The grandeur of the cave attracted further imperial attention. In 1313, a Mongol prince from Xining restored the facade. And then, to make this larger point then, the Palimpsest of Merit records the links between elite clans from Mount Wutai, or Taiyuan, just west of Beijing, to Khotan, near the Tibetan-Indian border. In just this one cave, then, 4 centuries of social and political networking are recorded through the representation of patrons. So here, despite a few exceptions, here, Zhang Dachen making some copies of donor portraits. If we can just generalize for a moment, artists seem to focus more on the history of style and color in the murals in the 1940s, not on the medieval history of the site. One can argue that they were acutely interested in what the site meant for them in the present, during the wartime period. The murals were interpreted through the lens of the Republican era. For example, in Cave 323, which Rong Xinjiang talked about earlier, Zhang Lechen developed a copying style that imagined the mural's original appearance, known as Fuyuan, producing paintings that erase the ravages of time. The colors have changed here since the early Tang, which you see on the right, and in Zhang's own copies, he effectively takes away political and cultural time by taking away the blemishes. And we might describe this over-identification with wall paintings as a slippage between past and present. This anxiety, according to Pierre Nora, for lieux de mémoire, or sites of memory, is that everything and anything could potentially disappear or slip from memory. And this acute sense of the past is relevant in sites where historical continuity persists, but where there has been some break, a perceived tear or trauma. And the copies were real efforts to recuperate those memories. So moving on to another artist, Dong Xiyuan, and just doing this briefly, Dunhuang researchers and copyists attach deep meaning, layers of meaning, to the wall paintings and the region, but during this period there wasn't a standard approach to copying the murals, as I think there is now, we could say. If Zhang's copies were a utopic vision of the murals' original state, what they would have been, Dong Xiyuan worked in a range of styles. In a section from the Salt of Mara, on the upper right, Dong has rendered all of the oxidized flesh tones in black and grays to reflect the current state of the murals. The same is true for the Buddha's teaching scene on the upper left. Yet for the scene of the Mahasattvajataka in the same cave, he has followed the so-called school of Zhang Dachen style of copying by restoring the original colors. And a comparison between their two approaches to the same mural reveals that Zhang, though he has used various techniques, kind of similar between them, we can see that he's omitted the facial features of his the figures to suggest a particular antiquity to the murals through his copies. But Dong's looks much brighter, newer, and more modern. When we compare Zhang's antiquated copy to the damaged section of the wall paintings on the left, we see all kinds of changes rendered in the new version. The blackened mountains have been restored to their bright or dahong tone, and the figures that were kind of reduced to a pale blue in the original mural are now rendered with a warm flesh or beige skin. So even though in the instance of Dong Xiwen and Zhang seeming to have practiced a similar form of restoring to the original appearance in their copies, the results are quite different. Dong Xiwen also developed what we can call a Dunhuang style for fresh new works in a secular mode, here incorporating Northern Wei motifs into a painting of a Kazakh girl. In the interest of time, we'll just move on, but this is a very interesting development during the 40s, these other paintings of different topics. So there were very few foreigners during that visited Dunhuang during the war, but one was Joseph Needham, who was, of course, the very famous scholar of the history of science, and was the author of the History of Science and Civilization in China. And his notebooks are very fascinating. He talks about navigating the site. And one thing that's quite interesting is that he made a sketch of the grounds, including the location of the first art institute, Dunhuang Art Institute, where Chang Su-hong first established the offices. And that's indicated up here on his diagram. So despite the varying degrees of comprehension of the murals in the 1940s, let us be clear that the site was more than just an attraction for Republican era researchers. It became a place to resolve issues of cultural survival and memory. Chang Shuhong's training in Europe, though, it gave him a particular edge, I think, and excellent grounding in realism using oils. This is reflected in his painterly renditions of the region, such as the Mongolian, the scene of the Mongolian yurt life after he moved to Dunhuang, and just many of that kind of style. This painterly idiom reflects his figure drawing training during 7 years in Lyonnais and Parisienne painting academies. The photographs, I think, also capture some of the joie de vivre among the Chinese artists who lived and studied abroad with Chang Shuhong. And the oil painting is of Chang's daughter, Chang Sana, that's held in the Musée Guimet. He tried to maintain this painterly approach in Chongqing during the war, where live models must have been very hard to come by. And it is clear that there's a shift in style after he returns to China from France. He experiments with a decorative, even orientalized flatness in which he collapses space. And in his Dunhuang mural copies, which you, one of them you see on the right, for which his freer painterly style was not that well suited, one senses the restraint on behalf of the national agenda. So I have a little video that I made with my students at Heidelberg, and it's a kind of a tribute to Fan Jinshi. The footage is from the late 90s, and so I'm gonna show that now.
Very short. 我来这儿从1964年从北京大学到这儿，已经在这儿度过了整整36个年头。敦煌研究院是1943年筹建，1944年正式成立的。敦煌研究院的成立特别标志我们中国有了一个独立的第一个专门从事保护研究这个石窟的这么一个机构。这一个世纪过去了，我们敦煌不仅发现了一个宝藏，这个世纪我们保护了这个宝藏，我们研究了这宝藏，也不仅我们中国在研究，而且世界上许多国家也在研究。那么敦煌学呢跟自然科学的好多新的科技一样，是这个世纪的新的学科，它给世界上搞历史学的、搞丝绸之路中西交通史的、搞我们中国古代各种文化的带来了新材料。
My only point is that Wang Chudong said it earlier that she's been at the site for 53 years and well over half a century. I think it would be hard to come by another scholar, or she's in a rarefied company of other archaeologists at sites around the world like Egypt or Greece or Italy. Where someone has been presiding over an archaeological site for well over a half a century. So she deserves all the praise and recognition she's been receiving today. Thank you.
Sarah is always the most updated. Now, digitalization, now it's film. speaking of Dunhuang studies, our second speaker for this panel, Dr. Zhao Shengliang, who is from Dunhuang Academy. He's a research fellow there and also the director of the editorial department of Dunhuang Research, Dunhuang Xue. Even I know very limited about Dunhuang Research, but I know Dunhuang Xue, Dunhuang Study is the most authoritarian scholarship with regard to everything research on Dunhuang. And of course, Dr. Zhao Shengliang is, devoted and also extremely accomplished in this field. It's reflected from his, I learned he has authored more than 60 articles and more than 10 books. So today he's going to talk about a study on the Bodhisattva figures of the Sui Dynasty in the Mogao Grotto. Let's welcome Dr. Zhao Shengliang.
Getty Center 给我这一次机会介绍我的研究成果，特别要感谢 Peter 先生为我做了翻译，因为我不会说英文。Good
afternoon, everybody. First of all, I'd like to thank the Getty for giving me the opportunity to present the results of my studies, and would also like to thank my interpreter for interpreting for me, as I can't speak English.
大家都知道，敦煌的艺术它延续了1000年不断绝的这种建造。 那么留下了大量的壁画和彩塑，所以我的一个最大的愿望就是希望对整个敦煌艺术做一个全面的美术史的研究。I
think everybody's aware that the construction of the caves that included the wall paintings and sculptures went on in Dunhuang for 1,000 years, and it was unbroken history. So it's always been my great desire to record the complete history of the arts in Dunhuang.
因为敦煌的内容太多了，我们分作五个阶段来进行研究。在这以前，我用了五年的时间把第一个阶段研究做完了，出了两本著作。
As this is a very long period, we normally divide the history of the arts at Dunhuang into five different periods. I've actually spent 5 years and finished research on the first period of history and have published two books on this.
我现在在做第二个阶段的研究，就是隋朝的。所以我今天报告的就是我在隋朝美术史研究里面有一个问题，对隋朝菩萨的形象的研究。
And the second stage that I'm doing research on includes the Sui dynasty. So what I'll be talking to you today about is the research that I'm doing on Bodhisattva images at Mogao Grottoes during the Sui dynasty.
Oh, 本来这个Peter先生为我翻译了英语，可是不知道为什么这个英文的没有进去。那么反正我画的图大家一看就知道，所以我想我是通过对这个隋朝的菩萨的 他的头冠、他的衣服、他的装饰，那么我们来看这个菩萨的形象里面包含的他的文化背景的问题。Originally,
Peter had actually put the PowerPoint presentation that I'd done into English, but for some reason we are unable to present it to you for today. So what I plan to do today is to show you through pictures and the Chinese you see on the screen, the crowns, the clothing, and the different images of the different types of bodhisattvas that you see here.
我想我的研究呢，我对它的每个部位进行一些分析。比如说头冠的形式，我们把它分作五个类型。现在我们看到图上的是，我把它称作花幔冠这样一个类型。
And I'm going to describe the different parts of the bodhisattva. And the first part I'll start with is the crown. And I divide, I think there are about five different categories of crowns that you find in the Bodhisattva. And the one you can see in the picture at the moment is what we refer to as the flower vine crown.
这样一个形式呢，一般是在彩塑里面，而且早期的比较多一点。
This is normally found in the sculptures, in an, especially the early period sculptures.
那么我们在早期的一些彩塑里面已经看到这样，它一直延续到了隋朝。And
we can see that this type of crown continued all the way through to the Sui dynasty and from the Beizhou.
我们看到这个另外一个类型的，它是完全用莲花花瓣形成的一个头冠，这是在隋朝出现的。
And this is another form, and this uses the flower petals of a lotus to form the crown.
那么到了隋朝中期以后呢，从这个内容就多了，有很多类型。主要的我们称作三珠宝冠，三个宝珠镶嵌在头上，但是它的三珠宝冠呢，分作几个类型。 有的是在树叶上面，有的好像是一个火焰的，有的好像是一个牌子扣上去的。And
then we developed to a different type, and this is a type of bejeweled crown that you can see here. And there are different types of these crowns. These appear in the middle of the Sui dynasty as well. And you see that the different types, some of them look like leaves on a tree, some of them look like a flame, and others look like a buckle you'd find on a belt.
这个我们也可以看到，有的在用三朵花形成了三个宝珠的背景，那么还有的在这个头冠的前面伸出一朵莲花来，这是特别的形象。And
there are three, you can see the three different styles here, and one even has a lotus appearing or protruding out from the crown.
这个三珠宝冠在早期呢，它是我们把它称作三个面、三面宝冠这样的形成，所以它从这个形式延续到隋朝做了一点改变。So
you can see that there were actually three sides to this type of bejeweled crown, and there were slight changes over the dynasties, right down to the Sui. So these three-sided crowns, you can see them both in Dunhuang, in Yungang, and also in Xinjiang.
那么我们从这个印度的壁画和雕刻上面呢，我们也看到这三个宝珠镶嵌在头冠上这样一个来源。
And you can see that these actually originally come from the India, and this is shown through the sculpture where you can see the bejeweled crown, the three-sided bejeweled crown.
那么还有一个类型的称作鸟头冠，好像一只鸟的头从上面伸出来，这样在壁画里面出现的比较多。
And you can see there's another variety, and that is the what we refer to as the head of a bird crown, and there are normally two heads of a bird there.
在早期敦煌的壁画里面，比如说北周时期，就已经出现了这样一个类型。
And these basically occurred in the wall paintings, early wall paintings in the Mogao period.
那我们看还有一个类型称作化佛冠。其实化佛冠在早期的菩萨里面，除了观音菩萨之外，弥勒菩萨也同样带有化佛冠。
And there's another type, and we refer that to the illusion of Buddha crown. And this is found both in the Guanyin Bodhisattva as well as the Manjushri Bodhisattva.
那么除了不同的类型的头冠，在头冠上它还会装饰一些，装饰的最多的就是日月装饰，一个上面一个圆，下面一个月牙，表示太阳和月亮这种日月装饰。
And in the ornamentation that you find on the crowns, one of the most common forms of ornamentation is in the image of both the sun and the moon.
这个日月装饰在早期的洞窟已经出现了，但是在隋朝就特别多。
This type of ornamentation with the sun and the moon on it actually appeared very early in the caves in Mogao, but it was became particularly common during the Sui.
我们看到早期在隋朝呢，不光是敦煌，在内地的一些雕刻里面也有这样的装饰，头冠上日月的。So
it not only appeared quite often in carvings in Dunhuang, but also in other places around China, and you can see the images of the sun and the moon on the crown.
我想大家一定还记得刚才有一位先生讲那个丝绸之路上的钱币，那个钱币上面有日月的装饰，那个波斯的，就是伊朗，大概是六世纪晚期，这个时候的那个钱币，所以这个日月装饰它应该是受到伊朗的影响，就是古代的波斯的影响。
I think everybody just remembers the talk about the currencies or money on the Silk Road, and you can see that there was currencies from both Iran and Persia, and you could see quite clearly the images of the sun and the moon on these currencies. So I feel that, you know, this type of pattern probably was influenced from motifs from Persia.
我们讲下一个问题，璎珞的问题。那么我把它分作几个类型，第一个类型呢，它就是在
The next aspect of the crown of the Bodhisattva I'd like to talk about is the necklace. And the first type, there are several categories of necklaces. And the first type I'd like to talk about is the one that is close to the neck but is also very wide.
第二个类型呢，它是两道这个璎珞装饰在脖子的这些地方。
And the second type is where there are two strands around the neck.
那么第三个类型呢，它这个下面的璎珞比较复杂，一直垂到下面有交叉成一个十字形，从两边分开，中间还有一个方形的，好像锁一样。
The next type is, the third type is quite complicated, it's quite long. It flows right down to the front of the abdomen where it crosses over, and it seems to be joined by a buckle that looks like a lock.
那么我们对比在中国内地的一些雕塑呢，会发现这种璎珞装饰，尤其是交叉下来，分作两边这样一个类型的，就很多从内地传来的。
And if you compare this type of necklace with other sculptures throughout China, you can find there are quite a few different types. That is the type where the it flows down to the abdomen and then crosses over the abdomen with a buckle there.
好,我们看下面一个问题,就是菩萨的飘带的问题。这个飘带呢,基本上只有两个类型,一个类型顺着这个胳膊往两边分开的,一个类型呢,它要从中间穿过两道的两个类型。
The next slide, I'd like to talk about the sash for the Bodhisattva. There are two basically styles of sashes. One is where the sash follows down both arms, and the second style is where the sash goes down the center.
所以大家能够看清楚。那么下面我们讲这个衣服的问题。这个菩萨最初大概是没有穿上衣的，所以这样的类型在隋朝还存在。
And now I'd like to talk about the robes or the garments worn by the Bodhisattva. In the earliest types, you can see that in the upper part of the body, there were no garments.
第二个类型,它是穿了一种上衣,我们把它称作身旗支,这是佛教的一种内衣,它是用一块布这么斜着挂上去的,这样斜下来。
The second style was when the upper part of the body was covered by a toga, or at least half of it was covered by a toga, and it was put on an angle.
第三个类型呢，这个衣服大家看，有一个带子这样跨下来，可是右边的胳膊露出来，所以我们称作右毯衫这样的形式。And
the third type was when there was some covering over half the upper body, but on the right-hand side of the body, it was left exposed. So we refer to this as a Chinese style of toga.
那还有一种方式，就是让菩萨穿上了袈裟，这样的形式。And
the fourth style is when the Bodhisattva wore a cassock.
好，我们现在看裙子的样子。So
now I'd like to talk about the outer robes.
一个最简单的裙子就是，他用一块布围起来围。 在腰部拴一根带子，这样的话是最简单的，所以这是菩萨的形式。The
most simplest type of robe, outer robe worn, was just a piece of cloth that was wrapped around the waist, and then it was tied with a belt or a piece of cloth in place.
那么在这个菩萨的裙子，它有可能里面有一块翻出来的一块布，这一块布呢，它会朝一边翻一个角出来。
Another style was when they would have the simple cloth around the waist, and on the outside there would be another piece of cloth that would flow over on one side.
那么还有一种办法是两边都翻出来，这又是一个类型。And
the second style was when there was cloth that came on the outside of the outer robe on both sides.
我们看最后一种呢，它是完全翻出来形成一个圆形的，这是翻出来的方法形成了不同的类型。And
the third style was not when it was partially put on the outside, but when a cloth was put totally on the outside, so the cloth would wrap around the whole body on the outside.
那么还有一个很复杂的形式，就是它有三件套装，就是上面有上衣。 那么下面有裙子，中间这一块，中间这一块还有一个小的衣服把这个腹部围起来，这三件套的形式。And
there was even a more complicated style where we refer to the three-piece type of clothing, where on the top there was the Chinese style toga, where the right hand part of the body was left uncovered. And on the lower section of the body was the outside robe. And in the center of the body was a small piece of cloth that covered the abdomen or the stomach.
看起来这些很时髦的菩萨的衣服，大概是从中国当时最流行的一些好看的衣服。因为在内地的，比如说在钦州或者在山西的一些菩萨身上，我们可以找到它的来源。
And you can see that this is probably the most popular form of clothing that was worn by the Bodhisattvas in that time. But you can actually see from these different types of statues here, the different types they used, and you can trace back their origins as well.
哦，不对。啊，特别是这一个菩萨的雕塑，我们可以看出它的衣服，除了那个裙子的上面一层，还有一道比较小的，也跟裙子连起来那个衣服，所以跟敦煌的有很多一致的地方。And
you can see on this particular statue that there is another robe on the outside of the outer robe. And it's slightly different from what we'd find in Dunhuang.
所以我们从上面看到这些类型，每一个类型，都可以，我们找到很多相比较的例证，我们知道它的来源有一部分从中原传过来，有一部分是从印度或者是中亚传过来的。So
when we compare the different types of clothing found on the bodhisattvas, we can actually work out where they're from. Some come from the central plains of China, some come from India, and some come from Central Asia.
所以我们根据这个菩萨的这种服装的，还有他的装饰的这些形式呢，我们大概能了解这个文化背景，就是说它有的部分从这个西边传过来，有的部分从中原传过来，在隋朝这个时代交汇到一起。
So from looking at the clothing and the ornamentation on the bodhisattva, we can see the cultural backgrounds or setting of or where the actual culture comes from. Some of it comes from the western regions, some of it comes from the central plains of China. And during the Sui dynasty, there was an integration of the styles.
因为时间的关系，我不能把每个样式展开来讨论，所以今天呢，我就简要的介绍这样的形式。我想，让大家知道，这个我们对美术史的研究，通过这些细部的特征来讨论每个时代的它的风格特征，还有它的源流的问题。Due
to time constraints, I really can't talk about each individual style in greater detail. But I'd just like to let you know that back in Dunhuang, we're doing research onto the art history of the different periods of different times. And through that, we can actually tell which forms came from the west, which forms came from the central plains, and the different styles and characteristics of their different periods.
好，我的报告完了，谢谢大家。
Thank you very much.
Thanks to Dr. Zhao and his thorough stylistic analysis on the Sui Bodhisattva. Our third speaker, also the last speaker, is Professor Eugene Wang from Harvard University. Professor Wang not only engaged in a very kind of wide encompassing research in Buddhist art, he actually, hard to catch up, he, his research spanned from early Chinese art and archaeology to modern and contemporary art and cinema. And also, every so often, I follow his scholarship pretty closely. He would kind of take us to a higher realm or something, make us think. And I think today, his talk is very much reflect that. His topic is how images meditate in cave. Let's welcome Professor Wang.
Thank you, Hui-Shu. And thank you, Neville and Marsha and the Getty Institute for inviting me to this exciting event. Let's see. It is hard to get people to agree on anything nowadays, but one thing that most people can agree on is that meditation is good and that strongest tradition of meditation comes from Jainism and Buddhism. So our knowledge of this tradition is largely derived from the vast body of Buddhist literature on meditation. To the extent that meditation involves acts of visualization, we naturally want to find out what it was like visually and how it was a picture rather than described. For that Dunhuang offers us some of the best examples, and the best Dunhuang caves feature some of the most comprehensive and systematic pictorial program of meditation in the world. Their full programmatic logic has only recently come to light as, and you can indulge me a bit here, my own research has just evolved, and I'm actually taken by surprise to find some of the things that I never thought were there before. Now, before I take you through one of the programs, let me just make one point clear at the outset. We habitually speak of Dunhuang as the largest art gallery in situ in the world, and we say this mostly to impress the general public who know very little about Dunhuang. We also know that this analogy can be misleading because the cave did not function as art galleries to attract visitors. They were mostly family shrines for ritual functions. Now note that I use the word functions, not practice or activities. Here the plot thickens. Did the murals strictly depend on ritual activities, that is, people doing things in the cave? Did the murals depend on these activities to make sense? My answer actually is that not necessarily. Take, for example, meditation. Just because Dunhuang caves contain pictorial programs of meditation doesn't mean that these paintings depend on real-time practice of meditation in the cave. Little in the Buddhist literature suggests that meditation involves looking at paintings. If so, what were these meditation-themed murals for? My answer is that they still fulfill ritual functions, but not the kind of that you normally imagine. So let me use Mogao Cave 254 to demonstrate the point. Let us start with four stories painted on the wall, and don't worry about where they are for the moment. So the first one is the tiger story, which is about three brothers outing, and the youngest brother noticed that the hungry tigress is noticed the hungry tigress is starving to death because of lack of food, and he sacrificed his body to feed the hungry tigress, and that's the famous tigress Jataka. Jataka means Buddha's former life. And the second one is King Sivi, as King Sivi saved a dove being chased by a hawk, and by allowing the portion of flesh to be gouged out so that he can feed the hawk. And in the end, he just, because they struck a deal, and it's a complicated story, but just to say that in the end, he just threw himself onto a scale so that he can weigh equally with the doves. The third story is the defeat of Mara, and it's about from Buddha's life, and Princess Siddhartha sits and subjugate the demons, Mara, and especially reducing the three beautiful daughter of Mara into old hags, and just to show all these shall pass. In any case, so these are the three stories, but the fourth one is the previous three ones you can get from any textbook, and in fact, if you could visit Dunhuang, that's what the tour guide will tell you, so that's not my discovery. So what I want to really dwell on is actually the fourth one, which up to this point has been misidentified, and so today I hope I can set the record straight. The scene is largely about enlightenment through meditation, which occurs in the night after the Bodhisattva's defeat of Mara. It's a transformative experience whereby Bodhisattva becomes a Buddha. Sitting under a Bodhi tree, the Bodhisattva enters a succession of four levels of meditative trances. Now, graduating these successive levels of four meditative states is at times conceptualized as a progression through cycles of universal destruction by natural elements. In other words, what you see is that from this, the set of four stages, and first is fire, second water, third wind. So the fire destruction correspond to the, you see the fire there on the rim, yeah. Correspond to the first level of meditative trance. The water destruction gets one to the second level. Wind destruction produces the third level. The fourth level is never subject to these universal destruction. Therefore, you see that here's a youngish face emerging from it. You could actually see they kind of start to age, start to grow beard, and then finally you kind of transcend time and emerge from at that cycles of destruction. So upon reaching the fourth level, the meditation attains the six supernatural cognitive abilities, in Chinese called Liu Shen Tong, in Sanskrit, Abjina. So these are the six supernormal cognitive activities, abilities, and they. The first one is that you start to levitate and so forth. And the second one is that you start to take on the eye that allows you to see things across time and space. And the third one is you start to have a heavenly ear that can allow you to hear all kinds of sounds from the entire universe. And the fourth one is that you have the knowledge of other people's minds, knowing what they were thinking about. And the fifth one is that you know, see your own past lives, your own previous existences, and others' previous existences. And the sixth one is very important for us. It's called extinction of outflow. Outflow means some kind of worldly contamination and some attachment to the world. So if you cut off that, that means you're getting there. So so the first of the set of six abilities, the unimpeded bodily action, is at work in our painting. It is demonstrated by the levitating Buddha. As you can see, he levitates and there's a space beneath him. So in Buddha's life, there are a few occasions of levitation. The most notable instance is actually when Shakyamuni attains enlightenment. The Buddha declares that he has ended craving. The divinities demand a graphic display, so the Buddha levitates to the height of seven palm trees. Now, the practice of meditation produces pyrotechnical wonders. On the strength of meditation, the Buddha soars into space, and there displaying himself, walking, standing, sitting, sleeping, emitting fire and water from both his sides. And thunder with lightning shook the heaven and earth, so it was pretty spectacular. Other peripheral scenes, vignettes surrounding the levitating Buddha contribute to the central thrust of enlightenment through meditation. The two vignettes to the bottom right and left are about cutting off attachment to the worldly desires. The scene to the right is about the conversion of Rahula, Shakyamuni's son, much against the mother's initial resistance. Finally, ordained by Modgayana, the guy who's asked to tasked with converting him. And by the way, Modgayana is Victor's favorite, in Chinese called Mulian, Victor's favorite character. And so Rahula was converted, and then conveniently, Shariputra becomes his tutor. So not coincidentally, both Shariputra and Modgayana are present to complete this conversion scenario. Likewise, the bottom left scene is conversion of either Shakyamuni's wife or his stepmother. Again, the point is to visualize the concept of cutting off worldly attachment. Now, the stream scene is related to these two leave the household vignettes. The scenario of two figures standing in the stream making offering to the levitating Buddha fit several such scenes in Buddha's life. Given that these two figures are hallowed celestials, they are More likely part of the partitioning scene. So what is partitioning scene? Well, it's the when the Brahma kings and celestials entreat the Buddha to rescue other creatures engulfed in the mournful sea of birth and rebirth, which he himself has just crossed and escaped. Again, the supernatural cognitive ability is the key governing concept here. So the highest capacity of the six supernormal cognitive abilities is to terminate the outflow, the worldly contamination. And this concept, outflow, is often visualized as a stream, which not coincidentally appears right here. As you can see, this is depicted as the greenish part is a stream. So all these diverse vignettes, the leaving the household scene, the stream, and the levitating Buddha, combine to make a central point loud and clear. The point is to demonstrate the extinction of the outflow of worldly contamination. The ability to do so is called the ability to end the outflow, one of the six supernormal cognitive abilities. What about the other abilities of the supernormal cognitive abilities? They are indeed embedded in the composition, which includes the bodhisattva in Tushita heaven. Before he descends into the human world to become the Buddha, he is said to use his heavenly eye to scan the universe, and actually also use the heavenly ear as well. We thus ticked off three of the list of six supernormal cognitive abilities. What about others? It is helpful to step back and take a broader view of the entire program of the cave design. Now, to recall, four narratives are featured here, two jatakas and two episodes from Buddha's life. The cave design program follows a very strict symmetry. The program, as most Buddhist narratives do, pushes toward the nirvana as the endpoint, a condition presented by both the stupa pillar that you see in the previous slide, and the west wall behind the pillar. So if that's the case, two oddities stand out. First, there appears to be something fundamentally wrong with the timeline. In Buddhist timeline, as we all know, that all these jatakas are supposed to be the former existence of the Buddha, and they will be followed by Buddha's life. So instead, here the order is reversed. If we agree that the whole cave pushes towards the inside, then you should start with the jataka, that's the former life, and then the life. But here, the order is reversed. Secondly, the way the Buddha's life itself is presented is quite strange. The program omits the entire sequence from the birth up to the defeat of Mara. This is the equivalent of whopping 12 chapters after 26 chapters in Ashvaghosha's Acts of Buddha. The design appears to cut the chase, getting to the defeat of Mara and enlightenment in a hurry. So the question is, what for? A fruitful question is to ask, what do these two episodes in common? The answer is meditation. How does meditation work or come down to? By way of six supernormal cognitive abilities. We have discussed three of them, and here I want to introduce another one, that is the ability to know the power, or to have the power of knowing the previous lifetimes, both his and others. Now, the cave design makes this point through sequencing. First, we have the levitating Buddha preaching, presumably narrating the story of his own previous life. Then a previous life story is conjured up, in this case, the CV Jataka, that is King Jataka, the former existence of Buddha, who allows his flesh to be gouged in order to save the life of a dove. Now, these Jatakas involve quite gruesome scenes. In the case of its facing wall, you have the young prince diving off the cliff to feed the hungry tigress. And then in this case, you have a king having his flesh gouged out. Now, these are sort of nightmarish scenes, quite horrible to our modern sensibility, but we would miss the point there. They are actually conceptual entities spelling acts of generosity. In other words, they are generosity writ large. As mental events, these acts of generosity amount to good karma. And good karma produce good feeling, a psychological state analogous to heaven. So in other words, for Buddhism, cosmology is always a psychology. To be heaven means that you are in a good state of mind. How do you acquire good state of mind? You accumulate good enough karma. And how do you acquire karma? You have generosity. So in Buddhist scheme of things, you know, heaven is a state of mind and achieved through meditation. Another major testimonial to the power of meditation here is the miracle of the double appearances at Shravasti. There, the Buddha put on the show of mental power. He can project others who acts and talks independently. Here, the design is actually have the Buddha in meditation and the other raise his hands in speaking, as you can see here. So one of them is a real, the other is a projection. But the thing is that the designer made them both act as if they can act on their own. And also, the Buddha can concentrate on both water and fire at the same time, and you also have the twin figures emerging from one the mango tree stem, and that's an ultimate statement about the nature of double appearances, which is this sort of miracle that is worked up through meditation at this stage. So the ultimate moment of the miracle of travesty is that the Buddha flies into the sky and fills the sky with 1,000 Buddhas. And the 1,000 Buddhas constitute the finale in the cave. The final act of meditation is embedded in the end zone of the cave, that is the new Nirvana zone. Early Buddhist meditation guide gives instruction to how to meditate in a cave. Picture a cave in your mind. Imagine yourself entering the cave, and then you can see an image on the wall. It can only be looked at from distance. If you draw close, you don't see anything but the wall surface. If your mind is too clouded with the bad karma, you don't see anything at all. Repent and re-clear the mental blocks, you get to see the image on the wall. This is to say that this image here is a rare vision, not something easily obtainable. It often takes hard mental work, intense meditation, to get a rare glimpse of this precious vision. Buddhist literature described what it looks like, this image, often dazzling, effulgent, and resplendent. Now, this real wall delivers that vision. The uncolored image is the painter's way of showing the dazzling full splendor of the Buddha beyond any color scheme. The image also displays some of the 32 distinguished features of the exalted Buddha, for instance, the wedded fingers. As you can see, the finger is wedded. The Buddha is both there and not there. Viewed from a distance, the composition actually does not tell the whole story. Upon close inspection, you will find that each of the smaller Buddha image actually carries a name tag, that is a cartouche. So these names group the Buddhas into different time frames. If you draw a line in the middle, all those to the left are the Buddhas of the past, and all those to the right are the 1,000 Buddha of the future. The Buddha in Nirvana in the middle, therefore, inhabits the virtual space where past and future merge into one, or simply is being transcended. Now, adding to this effect is some very deliberate artistic treatment. The Buddha who has passed into Nirvana is supposed to be reclining. Here, the Buddha refused to lie down, signaling that he's not really gone. In showing his continual presence, the back wall of Indian caves typically opens into a recessed sanctuary occupied by a statue. Here, the back wall shows a painted image that pretends to be a statue, but it is not. Its point is that here is a vision manifested on the wall. So what does it mean to paint this vision on the wall? A vision is an epiphany, an epiphenomenon resulting from meditation. Here in the cave, the vision is permanently fixed on the wall. This is inherently contradictory. A vision is no longer a vision if it's always there. This returns us to the question of why picturing a meditation process on the cave wall? What for? Now, Buddhist ritual manuals do not require the meditation practitioners to look at the painting while doing the meditation. Now, given that these are lay communities' family shrines located in distant mountainsides far away from their urban residences, it is unlikely that the caves were used to teach the untutored practitioner how to practice meditation. Nor was it intended as an art gallery to attract visitors. After all, in this remote mountain area, it is a costly undertaking to excavate a cliffside, dig a cave, and turn it into an embellished shrine or sanctuary by hiring skillful craftsmen to paint a full meditation program on the wall. So the answer is simple. It actually carries benefits and ritual efficacy. We can postulate the rationale behind this, given that the meditation helps stamp out past transgression as prerequisite for good karma, leading to present and future well-being. It is conceivable that the patron family had the meditation program painted and permanently fixed on the cave wall, so that past sin is absolved, good karma is produced, accumulated, and in evidence, resulting in benefit-conferring mechanism that can produce efficacy for perpetuity. In other words, they can count on the meditation mural in the cave, working its wonder for good. We now call it technology and automation. Thank you.
Now, can I invite all the speakers joining me to the front? So we'll start the Q&A session. What's the first question?
Thank you, Eugene, for a interesting paper, as always. Just a few questions. I haven't read the paper, but if I understand you and you're identifying the image as the scene that would immediately follow, in other words, if it's meant to be a particular point in the biographical narrative of the Buddha, and this is a point following the defeat of Mata, and you know, when he following the recollection under the rose apple tree, then you would be identifying an image that, as far as I know, has no separate depiction anywhere else. I don't know if you found any. It would be a one-off, unless you have other instances of this. But there's also just a problem if you take it literally as part of the autobiographical narrative, because then Shariputra and Moggallana should not be there.
Excellent question. Well, actually, this is not one-off. Actually, I've collected about at least three Northern Wei caves in Dunhuang has exactly the same pairing, and they cut to the chase right away. And in Kitzel also, that's largely the case as well. In other words, typically they will skip a lot of those earlier episodes and get to the subjugation of Mara. And so that's not a one-off instance. As to why Shariputra and Modgayayana are there, I think they're there for many, because Modgayayana was a guy sent by Buddha to convert his son, Rahula. And Shariputra became his son's tutor. So I think for that sort of narrative coherence, they are there. And also they flank the Buddha, levitating Buddha, makes sense because Modgayana holding a diamond scepter is often a sign of resolution. In other words, because that larger point made there is that you are willing to cut off from the attachment of the world. And that requires resolution. Therefore, Modgayana embodies that resolution, whereas the Shariputra embodies that wisdom. So that's how they work together, I think. Both conceptually. Right. Yes, in a different way. You know, it's the biggest discovery actually is now. I just had a seminar, graduate seminar, completely devoted to Cave 285. And we've just found all kinds of stuff about meditation, and that continues that use of those seated figures in the cave painted on the wall. Not the set of four, but they use other conceptual frameworks. But you see the models look the same. Seated figure inside the cave painted on the wall in the sequence. And actually also that set of four appears in Ajanta, in a number of cases in Ajanta, in cave temple. So we've just found that. And it's very exciting. They actually look more or less the same. They also do this, which is remarkable how Chinese faithfully replicated that design. Yeah.
Oh, next question.
I was curious about the halos or nimbuses in the Buddhist art in the caves. And when I went to look online, it said that the first halos were from the Hellenistic, in art history, were the Hellenistic images of the sun god Helios, and that in Buddhist art, it first appears in the second century in India. And it was suggested that the images of the nimbus came into India from Greek conquerors, which would be Alexander the Great, which is like a gap of 400 or 500 years. So maybe you could talk about what happened in that period of time and before it was actually expressed in Buddhist art.
Well, there isn't much to talk about. In other words, you're right. In other words, the development is there, and it's most likely come from Mediterranean. And so as to why we need to refine that storyline, I mean, in other words, you're right, the large picture is there, and I guess there's no need to further.
Well, my question is if it's Alexander the Great who's bringing those images 400 or 500 years earlier, it seems strange that, I mean, a person lives and dies, and then they have no more real influence unless there's some artistic expression of the image. So it just seems strange that there's a gap, that there should be some image that someone had to look at in order to be inspired.
Yeah, in between time. Okay, yeah, well, I think Mr. Zhao were probably more into that kind of research than I'm more interested in the programming. And he seems to be more interested in the chasing the single motifs. And so maybe Dr. Zhao will handle that question.
Well, maybe I could say something while he's translating. I think that Indian art historians or historians of South Asian art would kind of reject this notion that the elements of Buddhist imagery come from the outside. So the original, I would say the core of what goes into a bodhisattva, like the first representation of it's hard to translate when you're translating. It's hard to talk when you're translating. But the first representation, for example, Friar Bala, I think is circa 100 CE. Those elements come out of like auspicious folk deities and probably the money god, for example. And maybe, you know, this... And there are halos that go that are earlier, you know. So there is a kind of connection to perhaps back to Alexander the Great. And the story there is that artists probably stayed in the regions and certain designs carried on. But the core of this auspicious being who has a kind of inner breath and circulates that inner breath through yogic practices and then pursues enlightenment, that is wholly, you know, a kind of indigenous to South Asia. And so it's not a kind of, it's not a case of so-called foreign elements coming in and then shaping the Buddhist image, if that answers your question. I was going to say something else because you had a question earlier, but then they're still translating. You had a question about Avalokiteshvara, and I also wanted to add, wasn't that you earlier? Yeah. I wanted to add to that because actually there's representations of Avalokiteshvara in the 9th century where they're simple mandalas, but they're still mandalas. And there's the female aspect, the wrathful aspect, and other aspects of Avalokiteshvara that are represented around a central figure of Avalokiteshvara. So it's not so much a question of gender, but there's aspects. And actually, Avalokiteshvara has 33 forms total, but the core forms are somehow expressed through male and female forms, but there's also the wrathful form. And in the 9th century, there's 8 core forms, and those seem to come from in Tibetan art practices. So it's, I wouldn't say that it's that Valerie was mentioning something that or Guanyin doesn't have any affiliation with gender, but that somehow all those aspects are encompassed by Avalokiteshvara. That's how I would put it.
因为我听得不太明白，如果说头冠的问题，比如说来自这个萨山波斯的影响，尽管在萨山波斯本地可能已经没有存在了，但在相当长的时间，中亚的影响到中国的西部和东部，由于很多中亚的，比如说粟特人，还有别的民族的人，他会在中国的。 隋唐这个阶段还在中国生活，他们会带来那样的文化，以至于到他本地已经没有了这样的东西，他们人还在中国，所以我们在中国隋朝、唐朝发现了大量的从中亚过来的一些人，他们带来的中亚文化是存在的。
I kind of didn't quite get the question, but I can answer a little bit about the crowns if you like. And that is, you know, you may ask why you don't see these images in the countries that they may have originally come from. One of the reasons may be that a lot of it was brought in from Central Asia, and these people then came and lived in China for a long period of time brought these images with them. And perhaps those images may no longer exist from where they originally came from, but because of their living in China for that particular time, that's why they still exist in China.
Okay, so can we move on to the next questions? Yes. There are two more.
Hi, Professor Wang. I really enjoyed your new interpretation of Cave 254. I'm just wondering, whether does circumambulation or the idea of circumambulation still feature a large part in the programming of the different elements, since it's a central pillar cave that's usually associated with that kind of practice? Thank you.
That's a familiar question. A lot of people are prompted to ask. Well, my answer is that actually the program doesn't depend on the circumambulation, because this, as you can see, that it's rather symmetrical in design, so from the front to the back. But I mean, people could circumambulate. It could happen. It might have happened. But my point is that regardless whether they happen or not, the program itself makes sense. And another striking point, I didn't have time to, you will be all surprised to hear, that is, I show that back wall with the Southern Buddha, that's the breathtaking image. The truth of the matter is, it never exists. It doesn't exist. There's no such image, because that image was stitched. In other words, no one in the cave would be able to see that image, because the pillar would block your view. So you never get to photograph that image. And that whole image, actually, well, thanks for Sarah, who headed that Mellon project. They photographed and stitching hundreds of captures and make that a computer simulation. So which is to say that, you know, a lot of these paintings actually are not to be meant to be seen in order to be meaningful, because they are there. They are part of the big picture, part of the big program, and that program is meaningful in doing its things. And therefore, regardless the actual people were there visiting, doing things, practicing circumambulation, it remains meaningful regardless. That's my theory. Yeah.
Sarah, do you want to comment on that?
No, but I have a question for Eugene. Maybe I missed it, but what's the white-robed Buddha? Because it appears in about three or four other caves. So I just, what's the meaning of that? Is it a Buddha in Bhumisparsa Mudra, or is it in Vitarka, or what's the mudra?
No, it's not the mudra itself. It's actually the key. Yeah, right. The key in the scholarly debate for quite some time is the so-called bayi for the white robe Buddha. But uh-huh. That itself is modern misnomer. It's not. Oh. That doesn't mean it's really a white robe. It just means it's uncolored. Uh-huh. And then the question is why it is uncolored. Uh-huh. And so in the end, through research, we found that in fact it just means that it's so dazzling and splendid that it transcends all kinds of color spectrum. Uh-huh. So therefore, it just means the way that it's dazzling.
And so, is the Buddha already enlightened at that point, or is he
Nirvana? It's an image, so-called a shadow image that you don't normally get to see. And mm-hmm. This in itself is a testimony that you've succeeded in your meditation, because you don't see this rare vision. This is supposed to be very, very rare. And you don't often get to see them. Mm. So the minute that you see two things, you know you're successful in meditation. One is that you see this splendid image. Mm. Secondly, you see Southern Buddha filling the entire room, mm. Mm. Which is of course your hallucination. But that means you're mm-hmm. successful. And the manual, meditation manual, will tell you that you're there.
Yeah.
Okay, there's a gentleman in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Just a quick and simple question from Professor Zhao. Thanks for the great dissertation on fashion accessories in the Dunhuang Caves. But after your dissertation about the togas and all that, I look at this image right in front of me, and it has no toga. And I'm wondering, is this a precursor indication fashion as it is in today's world, as it moves towards the modern world?
这个菩萨的上衣呢，在印度基本上是不用穿上衣的。在中国的早期的洞窟呢，是有一些没有衣服，后来中国造佛菩萨像呢会给他增加一些衣服。可是到了唐朝呢，很奇怪，他又恢复到没有衣服的状态，因为唐朝跟印度的交往。
It's quite interesting that in the early images of the Bodhisattva in China, there were no upper robes on the Bodhisattvas at all. And then as it slightly sinicized, you then discovered that they were putting togas or cloth on the upper image. But then as China opened up again during the Tang Dynasty, and there was more contact once again with India, they reverted to removing the upper togas as well, and so they restored to the upper part of the body not having any robes on it.
Okay, our time is up. So let's conclude our third panel, and thanks to all our speakers.
So let's give a round of applause for all of today's speakers. I'm Mimi Gates. I'm one of the co-curators of the exhibition, the director emerita of the Seattle Art Museum, and the chair of the Dunhuang Foundation. And it's just such a joy to be here with all of you, with scholars, colleagues, and friends, all who are engaged in the study, the conservation and preservation, the support and vitality of the extraordinary site that is Dunhuang. It's often said, Dunhuang zai Zhongguo, Dunhuang xue zai Shijie. Dunhuang is in China, Dunhuang studies belongs to the world. And indeed, all humankind should care about the Dunhuang cave temples, the site, the devotional art that is in Dunhuang in China and elsewhere. In the interest of time, and I'm all that stands between you and dinner, I am going to be very brief and leave the task of synthesizing our deliberations to Professor Lothar von Falkenhausen, who will speak tomorrow at the conclusion of the symposium. But I would like to express gratitude to the Getty, the Dunhuang Academy, and funders, especially the Robert H. N. Ho Family Foundation, who made possible this ambitious Dunhuang project, and to UCLA for co-sponsoring the symposium in honor of my good friend, Director Emerita of the Dunhuang Academy, Fan Jinshi. I'd like to single out for special recognition, first, the lending institutions in London and Paris. I don't think we ever dreamed we could put together this exhibition, and it was really their generosity, as Marcia Reed said this morning, that made possible the quality of this exhibition. And the fact that they entrusted to us many of their most important Dunhuang works is quite extraordinary. So I would like to express heartfelt gratitude to Jane Portal, Jan Stewart, and Clarissa von Spee of the British Museum, Susan Whitfield of the British Library, Natalie Monet of the Bibliothèque Nationale, and Valerie Zaleski of the Musée Guimet. They really had a great deal to do with what we're all able to see and enjoy here at the Getty. Secondly, I'd like to acknowledge Neville Agnew, who you heard from this morning. His 29 years of work as the leader of the Getty team, working together with the Dunhuang Academy, it really was what inspired this project. And I would just like to give a hand to Neville Agnew and his team. Also deserving of recognition are two excellent young art historians, and we worked as a team, Professor Shen Xueman and Mickey McCoy, and you'll hear from both of them tomorrow. They were instrumental in conceptualizing the exhibition, in carefully selecting the works which are included, research and writing the historical sections of the catalog. And I think they really exemplify how promising the upcoming generation is in advancing art historical scholarship firmly grounded in Buddhism and the Buddhist context of cave temples and their art. So in addition to celebrating the 29-year collaboration between the Dunhuang Academy and the Getty Conservation Institute, the Getty Dunhuang project was inspired by two goals, which accord with the goals of the Dunhuang Academy and also the Dunhuang Foundation US. The first was to make the treasure trove that is Dunhuang better known to a broad audience, especially in the United States. There really are very few Americans beyond scholars and primarily Asian specialists who've heard of this World Heritage Site. And second, and equally important, our goal was to advance scholarship on Dunhuang, which offers such an abundance of primary material, visual and written, and to encourage a new generation of Dunhuang scholars working collaboratively in China, in different countries throughout the world, and working across disciplines. If you're interested in the subject of Dunhuang studies, I recommend Zhao Shengliang's essay in the Getty Dunhuang exhibition catalog, and also Imre Galambos's insightful article in the May issue of Orientations magazine. So 10 years from now, how will scholars assess the state of Dunhuang studies in 2016? How will Dunhuang specialists at that time view the Princeton Symposium exhibitions of the low material at Princeton and Seattle, and the major Getty exhibition publications and symposium? In my opinion, 2016 will be seen as significant for Dunhuang, a year which celebrated and made better known this singular and sacred place in the United States. Also encouraging is the fact that there is increasing access to the rich trove of Dunhuang material. As we all know, there's high quality digitization, which has the capability to make Dunhuang written and visual material freely accessible. Now we have the internet, we have advancing technology. And equally important, building on the legacy of Director Fan Jinshi, the leadership of the Dunhuang Academy, Director Wang Shudong, and Deputy Director Zhao Shengliang will increase scholarly access to Dunhuang sites and material, sponsor conferences and visits by younger academics, share digital images and resources more broadly via the internet. And there's just no question in my mind that Director Wang's vision is inspired. Before closing, I'd just like to add, and Chris Hudak, the director of the Dunhuang Foundation, mentioned it, that the Dunhuang Foundation US is interested in supporting Director Wang's vision, particularly scholarly exchanges of varying durations for scholars outside of China to travel to Dunhuang, and for Dunhuang Academy scholars to travel to universities and institutions abroad. So you can feel free to speak to Chris or to who is here or to me. We all need to ensure that there is an emerging generation of Dunhuang scholars who are well-trained across disciplines, think creatively, and have access to sites in the full range of primary materials. Thank you all for attending today, and we look forward to seeing you at UCLA tomorrow. Thank you.